that make Paul Kruger and the Transvaal Boer Republic a great danger to the British Empire, and possibly the most dangerous man in the world with all that gold. And remember who the British Empire is. They are the bloodline. They know all about the Anunnaki. They know all about this ancient empire, this ancient gold mining. When they discovered that Paul Kruger discovered the Anunnaki gold, they went, oh my God. And they did whatever it took, and they threw 470,000 soldiers and a bunch of farmers on horseback and a bunch of Zulus with spears, because they couldn't allow a rogue president of some little Dutch colony down at the bottom of Africa to pose a threat to the British Empire. And therewith ends the story of Paul Kruger, because they succeeded. If they hadn't, or if Paul Kruger was smart, if he'd known what he had stumbled upon, he would have used that knowledge very differently. Unfortunately, I don't think he had any idea what he'd stumbled upon. What were these ruins for? They were not dwellings for people or cows, that's for sure. And unfortunately, our historians keep pushing this agenda. It never stops. Just a few months ago, they issued another book from Wits University showing exactly this and trying their best to support their silly arguments. Yes, there have been these ruins that were occupied by the various tribes and used for their benefits. But exactly the same way the Incas used the ancient megalithic sites to build upon them, the African tribes would find them and they would use them for their benefit. Of course they did. But that doesn't mean they were necessarily the original builders. They know about the builders. The ancient knowledge keepers of the African story know about the builders. But the people that occupied it just didn't know. And our poor historians have no clue. It's all about metamorphosized quartzite, and quartzite conducts sound. Remember, stones that ring like bells. And just to give you an indication how these stones ring like bells, we're going to play this little video clip, a little compilation from our museum, to make you realize that they really make beautiful ringing sounds, and it's the sound that is at the center of this growing body of evidence of advanced ancient technology.
Digital data can now be stored in crystals. This is a brand new discovery.
that they'd probably known about for a long time, but it suddenly leaked out, so they had to make it a discovery. So we can now store digital data in crystals. Except one tiny little crystal can store trillions of terabytes, so that's not good for business, because they can't resell you more, you know, memory sticks and crap, because it needs to keep the money thing going, right? So this is why you realize that ancient civilizations, because they didn't use money, they didn't have to create things to put into shiny boxes to sell to somebody, so they used silica in its original form, and the quartz in its original form. They didn't have to make beautiful shiny metal boxes for things, and this is why these ancient sites could actually be seen as giant silicon valleys and memory banks that contained a lot of information encoded in the stones. And I'm really looking forward to someone who figured this out a way, some 12-year-old kid, I guess, with his iPhone and some weird device. I mean, I used to do this when I was 12 and 13, 14, develop all these weird things that we had fun with, making crystal radio sets. Remember those? Crystal radio sets. Wow. What happened to those? Gone. Right? I used to make crystal radio sets, go stand across the road and tune into the frequency of my folks used to listen to radio, because South Africa didn't have TV until 1976. And then used to talk rubbish to my folks on my little crystal radio. And I'd scare them to death, because they didn't know that I was doing it from across the road. And today our kids have no idea. Today our kids say, I'm bored, I don't know what to do with myself. And they're like, go do something. Stop playing computer games and go be creative. So remember that some 12-year-old kid is going to go up to Stonehenge, plug his iPhone in, and start downloading some interesting shit from those stones. I just hope that he's going to share that stuff on YouTube before somebody kills him. 12-year-old found dead with an iPhone at Stonehenge. What this points to very clearly is that these ancient sites are just giant machines. This is what we're looking at here. Giant machines, giant energy generating devices, giant resonators. I mean, Brian showed you most of the stuff that he showed you resonates with my own research here. And the interesting thing is that all these ancient sites seem to be activated by light and sound. This is why they are aligned with the solstices and the equinoxes and the stars. We might not think that the stars are very bright, but they are. Every star has a specific frequency, and when that star comes up over there and that starlight goes into this little channel in the pyramid, it goes down and hits some activating key and a stone filled with silica and quartzite, and it activates a machine to do something. When the sun comes up over there at the summer solstice and comes down this tunnel and hits a standing stone at the end of the tunnel, it's like hitting enter on your computer, right? It activates a machine to start doing something. This is why these machines in ancient times are aligned with the movement of the sun. So nobody has to switch them on and off. They switched on by the passage of time to do certain things. And this is just such an amazing new way of looking at these things, because it suddenly becomes so simple. The fact that the pyramid has been photographed to give off some weird resonance clearly shows that it's still active, and the stone circles in South Africa are the living proof of that. You know what cymatic patterns look like. You saw the video earlier. This is apparently the cymatic pattern of the sound of the vowel A on a metal plate. And that's exactly what every one of these stone circles is. It's just a cymatic pattern, a representation of the sound frequency on that specific piece of the earth. Now, I've got lots of additional information to share with you, but that's just going to be another hour here. So every one of these specific stone circles was made in a specific way by discovering what the cymatic pattern looks like at that specific site and then putting the stones in that shape, which result in amplifying the cymatic sound, the pattern of the sound coming out of the earth, and the silica and the quartz in the stones starts to amplify it because it vibrates the stones, it vibrates the quartz. The quartz seems to create a standing wave that goes around and around and creates very powerful electromagnetic fields, electromagnetic waves, vibrating at very, very high frequencies in the gigahertz. We're dealing with a giant energy grid at the southern tip of Africa. And this is not just a theory, people. This is scientific fact. So if you confront somebody with this information And they said, it sounds like an interesting theory. This is not a theory. This is a fact, because we know this is going on. We've measured it. And what becomes really interesting is this magnetron thing, because a tiny little magnetron that can cut metal in a split second by being pushed into a laser beam that then goes through a crystal and goes through into a beam of coherent light, right, that can cut metal in a split second. I spoke to two magnetron experts and scientists, one in Glastonbury and one in Boulder, Colorado, and I asked them both, how much energy would a magnetron like that on the left, made out of quartzite, silica, how much energy would a magnetron like that create? And they both told me the same thing. More energy than all the power plants on Earth today. Now, we've got thousands of those magnetrons scattered throughout Southern Africa. So just imagine what's going on here. It's beyond our current understanding, because we have been lobotomized and turned into a species with amnesia. But we're waking up. So we measure the energy in many of these circles, and it's always the same. Very, very high frequencies in the gigahertz. The loudness of the energy goes into the dozens of thousands of decibels. And the electromagnetic fields are ridiculous. Here, this one here, we measured 33.5 gigahertz coming out of the walls. Nothing outside, okay? Remember, it's nothing outside. The frequency only comes in from inside, from the walls and inside of the circle. At 58 degrees represents what is referred to as the heat signature. That's the average temperature of the average temperature 300 meters below the ground. It's not the temperature on the ground, right? At 80 degrees Celsius, if you use that scale, 80 degrees Celsius tells you you're standing on top of a volcano. That's called the heat signature, the guy that did this measurement for me. So here we have 5.5 degrees heat signature out here. The moment you swing it into that little section there, it shoots to 58 degrees. 5.5 degrees to 58 degrees. Clearly something bizarre is going on there, and we don't quite know what, but the 33.5 gigahertz sound frequency coming out of these walls is an indicator that something very special is going on there. And then 580 megahertz electromagnetic fields in the megahertz to 580 megahertz is measured here. And that's just amazing. You start getting into radio frequency, broadcast frequencies here. And then the decibels coming out of this particular site is over 30,000 decibels. This is the loudness of these frequencies. Now, I hope this is making sense to you. That is insane amount of energy. It's just, we can't imagine it, really. 30,000 decibels. It's just ridiculous. At Adam's calendar, or Enki's calendar, as it should be called, really. I called it Adam's calendar, and so I'll take the blame for that. 9.5 degrees, as you approach the calendar, there is no wall there, people, so this magic happens here. In the stone circles, at least you've got walls. Here there's nothing, just a bunch of loose stones. As you literally walk, then you take a step forward from here to there, and everything changes. And the electromagnetic sound frequencies go to 375 gigahertz. That's just ridiculous. It's just nothing in nature that's measured those frequencies. There's nothing over here. Just ambient noise, 375 gigahertz. The electromagnetic fields run horizontally here. And the heat signature goes from 9.5 degrees to 77 degrees. But when you go between the two calendar stones, it goes beyond 80 degrees Celsius. So it increases there. And it's consistent with the measuring of the electromagnetic fields. At about 1700 megahertz around here, between the two calendar stones, it goes beyond 1800 megahertz, but it doesn't run horizontally, it now runs vertically out of the ground into the sky. So we have ourselves one of these. And this is not a theory, this is measured, scientifically verified data. Yep. This is why I have not appeared on ancient aliens. I'm not kidding you, they've approached me about six times. Oh, and then after the fourth contact with the producer, I never hear from them again when I start telling them what I'm going to talk about. They don't want evidence. beam up to God.
Yes.
That's what this is for. No, that's my theory. That is a theory, yes. But you know what? The gold is not here on this planet. It's somewhere else. I was going to find a picture of Abu Ghraib. If you've ever seen an aerial photograph of Abu Ghraib, where there's the pyramid, there's the beautiful platform that it stands on, surrounded by a wall, megalithic wall, then the pyramid, and in front of the pyramid is this beautiful circle, just like the circle here that these guys stand on in Star Trek. And you go, okay, this is a bit too freaky, people. And I'm suggesting that we are really dealing with some stargates here. This is stuff that is not becoming very visible. What were the channels used for? I'll just do this in here, because I'll take it in, I'll put it, take it out, put it back in, depending on the length. I thought that we got maybe a few extra minutes, because I'm the last speaker today. So you know, we got evidence of sound, frequencies, we got evidence of these wires that connect them, and electromagnetic fields that run. We know the electromagnetic trains that run, maglev trains they call, magnetic levitation trains, that they don't actually touch they just run on magnetic levitation. And I suggest that maybe this is what this was for. And to show you that the technology is there, and maybe they use it for that, something like this. And this cluster of hexagonal structures, what's it for? like honey, like bees growing their larvae, like ants growing their babies in hexagonal structures. And you realize that we're dealing with a lot more mysterious stuff here. And then we get here. This, I think, they were generating an atmosphere with. Oxygenating the atmosphere. Energizing the atmosphere. Or something like that. Why? Because the closest resemblance I can find to those structures is the tissue of the lungs, the cells in our lungs. This is what the tissue, the histology looks like. Just to remind you. Bingo. It's, like, what's going on here? It's a lot weirder and more mysterious. So this journey of discovery continues, and it really gets more and more exciting. And that brings us to the sacred stone, or the torus-shaped stone. We knew it was a powerful stone. We measured very powerful energies coming out of it. We had no idea how powerful it was. But there are many of these. I've got a bunch of them in my museum. In 2009, we were told about SASER technology. That's how new SASER technology is, people. Only 2009, when they suddenly told us, oh, you can focus sound into a beam, and it's far more powerful than a laser beam. Wow, amazing. And that's what I think that these were possibly used for, to generate the sound that then gets focused into the cone-shaped tool that creates the SASER beam, which does what? Sound that moves beyond the speed of light and hypersound distorts the gravity fields around it. This is well documented by Russian scientists in the 30s and 40s already. Vortex fields distort the gravity fields around them. And this is how I think the ancients used it. This is why they used these cone-shaped tools. And just these donut-shaped stones, I've shown to be, again, this German scientist that measured this, his name is Reinhard Giebensleben, and he measured these stones, even just standing idly in a room without anything happening to them, give off up to 3,500 decibels. So they pick up the ambient noise going into the center, the sound goes into the middle, and they spew it out around the sides, just like galaxies and solar systems create the energies where the planets are created, right? So they suck in the energy, and they spew it out at the equator. And we put one up. So if Edwin Skullman built Carl Castle with ice cream cones, and these Mayan deities were doing interesting things with ice cream cones, I think we have some interesting theories that are starting to get stronger and stronger. And we realized that these torus stones were toroid vortex generators. And we put one of them in a bucket of water, woke up the next morning, and these thousands of tiny bubbles formed, and they were spiraling around, going into the center of the stone. It's like, it just gets better all the time. I haven't been able to recreate it, but there it is. We did it once. That's enough for me. You know? And then I took the stone to Nassim Haramein in Hawaii 2 years ago in 2013, because I wanted to give it to Nassim to do some research in his resident project, and I thought he'd be the right guy to do it. Turned out that he wasn't the right guy, he didn't have the right... They were going in a different direction, so the stone has come back, it is now in the hands of these guys in Ashland, Oregon. Amazing guys, Eric Larson is one of them, the Simoscope guy. And there's another stone in the hands of another group of scientists near Boulder, Colorado. So we've got two scientific groups studying these stones now. But how many of you have heard the story of the donut-shaped stone on the airplane? How many of you heard the story of the plane? Okay, so a few, so I'll tell the story quickly. So Louise and I traveled to, we were sailing from Johannesburg, we packed the stone in bubble wrap and then packing tape and chuck it in my bag with my clothes. We leave via Arab Emirates, where we have a stayover at Doha International Airport, at which point we board for Chicago, USA. And my bag goes through TSA, home security scanning, homeland security scanning. We didn't know anything about this, and we were sitting on the plane, and the captain had said, you know, cross the doors, and close the doors, cross-check, and whatever they say. And 20 minutes later, we're still sitting. Nothing's going on. Doors are still open. At which point, I hear on the intercom says, Louise Clark, please identify yourself. And I look at Louise, and I go, what have you done? That's what I said. I thought, wow, why do they want you? And she puts her hand up, and the hostess comes running along, and And she says, you must follow me off the plane, ma'am. And I said, I'm not letting off the plane. I saw Midnight Express. I know what happens in the Middle East. I'm not going to come visit my girlfriend in a Turkish prison for the next 20 years. So I followed her to the edge of the plane where we looked down, and there was my bag on the tarmac with five guys with guns standing around my bag. So lots of confusion. It's not her bag, it's my bag. So eventually I go down. Now, as I'm going down the stairs, I go, oh my God, it's the stone. My stone is in my bag. Now I understood, because they cross-labeled our bags. And I'm going down thinking, what am I going to tell them? I can't tell them I've got ancient advanced technology in my bag. Because, you know, really, I was panicking, I was sweating. And I can't tell them I've got archaeological artifacts, because that's not permitted. I don't have a permit. I need a certificate and a permit, and it must be signed by the president and the who God, everyone must sign it, right? Before I get permission, I have authority. So I came up with a concept of calling it African Curios. Curios is a word for arts and crafts. Everyone has one of these in South Africa, man. Jeez, we give them out to everyone, you know, so I was working out the story in my mind, and it worked. So I open my bag, and I pull out this thing, and it's tightly wrapped. Now, have you ever tried to open with bare hands, with five guys with guns, something wrapped in bubble wrap, and then in packing tape without a knife? It's really not easy. And I did panic. I thought, if I don't open this thing now, they're going to bloody shoot me. And I don't know how, but within 30 seconds or so, I did manage to rip it open, at which point the stone popped out, and there was one African chap who, if I remember correctly, he was one of the guys without a gun. And he looked down and he went, oh, I've seen those before, and he started to walk away. And I really think that he's the guy that diffused the whole tension there. But what I only discovered many years ago, well, because it was, it's freaky, man. This stuff that affects you at a genetic level, because you suddenly realize that you're vulnerable, and you could go to Guantanamo Bay never to be seen again. That's what they can do to you. Remember, they can do anything, whoever they are. And so... I just realized 2 years later that they bought the story of the stone. They didn't make me search the rest of the bag. They didn't say, take all your clothes out and check everything. When they saw the stone, they went, lots of confusion and blah, blah, blah. Okay, put the stone back and close your bag. And I go back up. And by the time the captain had come out, he was standing at the entrance to the plane. He was saying, if the plane isn't in the air, within 2 minutes, I'm offloading the whole plane because it's getting too hot to take off. And we went back and we sat down, and Louise said, you know, when the captain came out of the cockpit, he was standing right next to her, and he said, whatever is in that bag crashed the TSA security system. Oh. That's why they delayed the plane. They couldn't figure out what the hell was going on, and they were obviously very nervous about this thing, because this doesn't happen very often. So my suggestion is that while they were scanning my bag, you know, they put all kinds of frequencies to it, one of those must have gone right into the middle of the stone. And that's how you activate it. And it just went. These things get off scale our waves, okay? This is serious advanced technology. Silicon-based technology in its most simplest, rawest form, using rocks, not silicon chips, silicon, you know, valley stuff. And that just, like an electromagnetic pulse, remember Ocean's 11?
Yes, yep.
Put out the lights in Vegas with an EMP. And I think that's what happened here. So, we can thank Homeland Security and TSA Security for providing the scientific and physical evidence that we're dealing with ancient advanced technology.
Why did they let you on the plane after that?
Good question. I don't know. Because I think the threat was over. You know, well, I really don't know. This is a bizarre situation. It remains bizarre, and I keep playing it over in my head. No, we haven't. But this is what I hope the guys in the labs will do. You know, when I gave them the stone, they started immediately asking me, okay, we're going to wrap copper wire on with this. I said, no, stop. You're going the wrong. Don't do this. The stone is the energy device. You don't have to wrap copper wire around it. You're going backwards, buddy. Just use what it's the way it's supposed to be used. This thing works with sound. So don't do anything other than put sound frequencies into it and measure what it does. Because somewhere you'll discover the magic. There'll be, you know, maybe you'll disappear at some frequencies, or the water will start boiling somewhere, or who knows? You'll crash all your systems in your laboratory. I don't know, but just experiment by putting different sound frequencies into the hole and then figure out. But let's carry on here, because the plot thickens. Really. All the ancient sites on this planet seem to be connected by this ancient grid. I know Brian spoke to you earlier by the way of Viracocha. Is that what you call it? The way of Viracocha? And that's one of the main lines. But if you start breaking it up and you look at all the energetic lines and the ley lines, and they come with many names, that all these ancient sites seem to be built on these intersections. They're not just randomly scattered. When they built these ancient sites, they knew exactly what they were doing. They were putting them in specific places for specific reasons. This is the Russian sketch of what they call the gigantic crystal grid. And it just gets more spectacular, because this Sumerian tablet, and by the way, this is not a Zechariah Sitchin translation for any of those who still want to bash poor Zechariah. This is from the Shoyan collection, and it says the following. In the distant days, in those days after destinies had been decreed, destinies for our planet and for wherever else, right? That would be Anu, and Enlil set up the regulations for heaven and earth. These are some serious dudes, right? They set up the regulations for heaven and earth. Okay. Enki, the exalted knowing God, by the rules for heaven and earth, the fixed rules, he set up cities. What I get out of this is that there's some sort of an energetic grid in the sky, the rules for heaven and the rules for earth, and this energetic grid is echoed on the surface of the earth. And according to this energetic grid that's echoed from the sky onto the earth, they built their cities, and they set up the ancient sites and the ancient temples and what we are discovering and marveling at today. And then, a couple of years later, a few years ago, David Wilcox started to expose the fact that the US military and the Air Force have these rules encoded in their logos. White lines around the planet Earth are referred to as the rules. And they call them the rules, some sort of an energetic grid around the Earth. They don't know where it comes from, but it's always been there. And that's why they put it around all their logos, together with all these other things that we're not going to go into, which is deeply encoded with a lot of other stuff. So, this is fascinating. And then, a few weeks ago, actually, about 2 years ago, my friend Paul Kravenstein called me when I started investigating this and realizing there's some more stuff going on. He's a guy that measures energies, he cures disease with sound and with resonance, he does amazing stuff. He can pretty much measure anything you want. He energizes the soil so the farmers' crops grow better just with resonance and no fertilizer. Paul throws me out of the blue. I haven't spoken to him for a year. He says, listen, I don't know who else to tell, but I phoned you because I thought you'd understand this. But I've been measuring this weird energy grid around the Earth. It's like completely out of the blue, right? And he says, it's this like this energy grid that's made up of a binary code. It's ones and zeros around the Earth. And I think, oh my God, we're living in the Matrix. And he says, it's so strong. When you breach it, it immediately starts to fix itself. So, and that goes in one ear, and I start thinking about where these ancient sites are located. And in Egypt, we have no better example than some of these ancient temples. And it becomes very apparent very quickly, as Brian showed already, that these are energy-generating devices. These long needles that stick into the sky are clearly either antennae that put something into the sky or they get something out of the sky. There are too many pillars, and they're all built on this big platform. And too many pillars and not enough space. Now that's really the main thing here. The obelisks ring like bells. When I put my ear next to this little piece here, and my friend Hugh Newman tapped on the other side, I nearly jumped out of my skin because it sounds just like those stones that I was playing. Same thing. So they're giant versions of those little stones that we find in South Africa. There are too many pillars, not enough space. These original structures were not for offering food or singing praises to the gods and so forth. That's the deception and the lies that we've been fed. When you start looking at them from the air, it becomes very clear that this is just, you know, too weird. These geometric patterns everywhere, that just, this is not for people or dwelling places. And the Parthenon, it was the mountain of the gods. People weren't allowed there. They weren't supposed to go there. And around the big famous ruin there, there are the remains of a structure that looked very much like the temples in Egypt. But the stuff is no longer there. All being taken away and stolen. There's an entrance portal here, and then there's this amphitheater here, another amphitheater there, and the plot just thickens. And the same thing as the Parthenon, and apparently that's where the people used to live, but it's got nothing to do with dwellings, so a lot to do with something very different. And again, too many pillars, not enough space on a big platform, concentric circles in front of it, no doors and entrances, resonating chambers, what are we dealing with here? Big open cavity, resonant cavity, too many pillars, and we start to realize that these temples are not temples for offering, but they're just templates of giant circuit boards. And that's what these things were really for. Silicon-based technology on a huge, gigantic scale. This one is just a dead devil. I mean, this is Persepolis in Persia or Iran today. Just filled with mysterious ancient structures. And when I did this contact in the desert, the guy came to me afterwards and said, he designs these, and he started explaining to me exactly how it works and what different parts of it would do. So, yeah, gigantic energy circuits, and suddenly we start looking at them very differently. And microprocessors become macroprocessors. Those are not dwellings for people, that's a circuit board, part of the circuit board, all generating huge amounts of energy, and hey, this is just insane. And these ones today are coated in gold, isn't it great? And the pyramid is no different, same thing. The mastabas, giant empty chambers, resonance chambers that all feed the big machine. The Bosnian pyramid, for example, is a great example that seems to simulate the function of the lungs. The Bosnian pyramid is filled with tunnels, and you know, Samuel Zvonimir just excavating the tunnels around the Bosnian pyramid. They're like these long arteries of tunnels that feed into the pyramid. And they're like the alveoli of the lungs, and the pyramid is the lung. So, and it seems that the air, that those tunnels are constantly filled with fresh air, with very, very high iron, positive iron content. So you actually heal, you go into those tunnels. People go in there and they talk about suddenly their backache is gone and they heal all kinds of diseases and ailments they've had, all the volunteers that he's got in there. And I realize that it's the same thing. Just the way we energize the oxygen we breathe, the pyramid, the Bosnian pyramid, uses the tunnels. As the wind goes through those tunnels and it probably creates some sort of vortex spiral, which seems to be the case from the scanning that we've got of the Bosnian pyramid, that it just energizes, the sound of the air moving in there activates the pyramid to do its job. So it's a slightly different version of the other pyramids or other ancient sites that are aligned with the sun. But the sound thing is critical. So the Bosnian pyramid, the sound is critical. And so it seems that the rules and the energy grip around the earth is created by these ancient, or upheld by these ancient structures, these ancient sites, and the human sound is the energy that holds it great. And we have amphitheaters. Must I finish, guys? Am I supposed to finish? You want me to finish?
No.
I see a convergence of management. Sends a fear into you, see? Fear authority. So what you see here is amphitheater. It seems that human sound is the energy, or creates the energy that holds up this grid around us. This is why they put amphitheaters in close proximity to these energy-generating grids. They get a bunch of people, and look why they create it so perfectly in sacred geometrical patterns, right? You get the acoustics in there are spectacular. Unimaginable to us today, how they got it so right, when they couldn't even, you know, they lived in caves. But you realize that they get a bunch of people in there, you scare them to death, or excite them, they make a lot of noise, or they get a lot of fear, and that's more energy. And you channel that energy into the circuit board, there's an entrance portal, you plug it in there, it activates the circuit board and creates a huge amount of energy. and sorry, going the wrong direction. And it's this that gets sent skywards, and this upholds the grid around the planet. And there's another one. There's your amphitheater. There's a beautiful resonating line of pillars that take the sound into the circuit board, which is now really badly destroyed. Here it is. Here's another one on top of a mountain. There's the remains of the circuit board. There's your amphitheater that used to connect to it. And here's the latest one I found in Algeria. Here's your amphitheater, the source of your sound, right in the middle of the circuit board. And guess what? Just even 2 or 3 days ago, when I was looking at Sacsahuaman, I hope that's a correct spelling, that Brian talks about so in so much detail, I saw these weird, these so-called, they call defensive walls. They're fascinating, but where do they lead to? Where do they go? And there are three, it's interesting, there are three of those. So there are two channels that lead in, right? And if you put sound or something into those two channels, or the wind blows through them and creates, and there's a, look at this weird zigzag thing. Why are they building the zigzag pattern, right? There's no real reason for it that we can come up with, so very obviously. But when you look at it from the air, another circuit board. And there's your zigzag patterns coming into the circuit board on top of the mountain here. And I suspect that if the wind blows in there a specific way, it creates a resonance that then plugs into the circuit board and activates it to do certain things. There's just an outline of it. There's your channels that lead in there. And there's your circuit board on top of the mountain. So another look. Here's another picture taken, a more stylized picture of the zigzag energy going in there. And then I found that there's actually a thing called zigzag wiring for transformers that create a special effect in transformers. And you go, okay, man, these guys are way ahead of the pack here, you know. So I just really wanted to show you, I threw this in this morning because it sort of feeds into the subject that we're discussing here. Nothing has changed in 2015, people. The temples have just been replaced by churches. The steeples, the what do you call them, the obelisks have been replaced by steeples, and you put people in there, they sing, they chant, they do all kinds of stuff. They get filled with fear more often than not. It's that fear and the guilt that creates the energy, and that energy just gets channeled upwards. Why on earth would churches have steeples? Who came up with an idea, right? Many, many years ago. Why? What is that? You know, if I gave you, if you've never heard of God or anything, or, and I say we're going to build a place to celebrate creation and celebrate our Creator, would you build a thing with a big steeple into the sky? I don't think so. It's not the design we're going to come up with. We're going to probably be a lot closer to nature. And then this year, when I did this presentation in Germany recently, at Eric von Däniken's 80th birthday event, a German lady came to me afterwards in a broken English, and she said, "Listen, I've been seeing sound all my life. And remember, our senses get muddled up. Sometimes we start seeing sound and hearing color and things like that, right? So our senses get muddled up. And she'd been seeing sound as a white, yellowish light all her life, and she thought she was crazy until she saw this presentation." And she told me she's been seeing, especially at like churches and the Vatican and government buildings, where the sound goes in, it flows into the bottom of the pillars, and then out the top, shoots into the sky. Right? And then on top, I mean, you can see, there's your resonant bubble and the cross, the source of sound and the resonant bubble. If you start analyzing this stuff, it just goes into a lot more detail. So, nothing has changed. Our business centers have now become the circuit boards. We don't need to build giant circuit boards anymore. That's why these ancient circuit boards are in such a state of disrepair. They don't have to work anymore. We voluntarily create our own circuit boards that do what? We make so much noise. These giant tall buildings resonate. They never stop vibrating with our noise and our energy, either from businesses or from our dwelling places. And huge amounts of energy. We never stop making a noise. And one circuit board is connected to another with channels that never stop making a noise. It just goes on and on. People are the source of energy that holds up the matrix. When I saw Morpheus say this in the movie, I didn't understand it. perception on that statement today. But now we know what's going on, and we can start working against that. What we've learned from this is that we need to make a change in our lives. We cannot continue on this path. We know that we live on a prison planet. We're not here by choice, doing what we want. We've been forced into slavery on a daily basis. Very few of us have any kind of free choice at all. We become absolutely enslaved to the system. We cannot move around freely, cannot live where we choose to. We need passports, work permits. We have to follow rules and laws that we didn't agree to. We have to work to survive, to earn this thing called money. The only species on this planet that has to use money. If you can't see anything wrong with that picture, then you clearly are lobotomized. Right? And this is not freedom, people. You know what this is called? It's called slavery. So when I say we live on a prison planet, you have the evidence of a grid around the planet. We cannot escape this. Somehow we're trapped here. There's a lot more to be discussed about the free will in terms of our reincarnation. And when you reach enlightenment is when you decide or realize you don't have to come back. You can go away and don't have to come back to this prison planet. And this is what people like Ashiana Dean call the blank slate technology, or the beast, where the Anunnaki actually created this grid that fries your soul, or the memory of somehow that your soul forgets where it belongs and that it's connected to source, and that you have the choice to go back to source. And this has caused the Anunnaki to create a great sin against all of humanity, according to some ETs that have reported this to some farmers outside of Minneapolis that were doing research on ETs living on their farms. Does that confuse you?
No.
Confuse me. But it makes it clear that whatever is going on here is not kosher. That we've been deprived of any choice or free will, and we've been caught in a never-ending cycle, karmic cycle against our will of ignorance. And it's when you reach this point of enlightenment that you sit through all this. Now that you know this, you've been set free. You can go home, and you don't have to come back. But if you choose to come back, you come back enlightened, and you come back with a purpose, and you come back with a mission to do something good for this planet. And this is the new age of enlightenment. This is what the ancients have prophesied. This is why we are the ones we've been waiting for, and this is why there are so many new children being born with this knowledge that we call, what do we call them, crystal kids and star children, all these amazing names we give these children. They know this. They've come back to do this work. You're now part of that group. You may have been part of that group for a long, long time, but hopefully this bit of information will give you a lot more real substance to be able to argue this point if you need to. And you can argue this on a scientific basis, believe it or not, because much of the stuff you heard here today is of a scientific nature. Money is an untouchable holy cow. We cannot escape the clutches of money, people. Wolfgang Goethe told us that no one is more enslaved than those who falsely believe they are free, and that makes most of us in the world today. What can we do about it? First thing you must do about it is go out and tell everyone. Because now that you know that sound and knowledge and truth resonates, the moment they hear this, the truth will resonate in their hearts. It'll resonate in their DNA. Whether they're prepared to hear it or not doesn't matter. Even if you just tell them a little bit about this information, it's forever stuck in their DNA and stuck in their consciousness. Go out and tell everybody, and this is where it leads to the whole new philosophy that I'll be talking about tomorrow.